Hello and welcome to Talent Explosion. I'm Bill Doherty, your host. Very happy that you joined in today. So let's get on with the show.
I pray you'll be all right and watch us where we go. Help us to be wise in times when we don't know.
Wasn't that amazing? That was Fernando Varela with the group called Forte, and that was at the finals of America's Got Talent Radio City Music Hall. We welcome today Fernando Varela. Thank you so much, Fernando, for joining us.
Of course, Bill. Thanks for having me.
Man, it's such a pleasure. So, you know, I know that a lot of our listeners are from here in the villages, and they already know a lot about you. But yeah, we do have listeners from all over the world that tune in to this show, thank God. And they might not know a lot about you. And so the purpose of this show is really to let people get to know artists on a really personal basis. So tell me, all right, you were born in San Juan, Puerto Rico.
Yep.
And you moved to Orlando.
When I was 8 years old.
8 years old with your family. And tell us a little bit about how you got involved with music and especially in opera. How did that all come about?
Yeah, I mean, you know, music was just such an integral part of our life and our culture. So there was always music playing at our house. We were always singing at home. We were putting on shows as kids. And, you know, it was interesting trying to, you know, assimilate into a new culture at eight, you know, nine, 10 years old. So, I remember I started singing at school, and I had this nice little boy soprano voice at, you know, 8 and 9 years old. And I was at St. Mary Magdalene in Maitland, and, the boys started making fun of me because of, you know, I sang a solo at church. And so then I stopped singing, like, publicly. You know, I'd sing at home or whatever. But, you know, and then in high school, my choir teacher, I was friends with her son. She was like, please come sing. Please join us. And I wouldn't do it because I had these you know, scars as a kid. And then finally, my senior year in high school, I was like, I don't care. I'm going to join the choir. I don't care. I'm a senior now. I've got my friends. I don't really care what people are going to say. And, it was a great experience. And I wish I would have done it sooner. I had a great time. And there I met a lot of friends. And of course, the connection that brought me to opera was I met my girlfriend at the time, Annie Griffin, singing right. in choir. And her mom heard me sing at like the spring or, you know, the fall concert, whatever, for high school. And she's like, oh, you really should meet Bill Doherty and study with Annie's voice teacher. And so she brought me along, and you heard me. And I mean, I was like nothing at that time, but I think you were just so desperate for men.
It was so funny because you used to come after like practice, I think basketball practice or something. Yeah. And yeah. you'd wait for Annie to finish rehearsal. And we were doing a show, and I needed guys so bad. I didn't care if they could sing or not sing.
I remember,
I said, hey, you, whatever your name is, get up
there. I remember you said, like,
opera now.
Yeah, you said, you're going to be in this opera. Don't worry, I'll teach you how to sing later.
Yeah. So anyway, those were some pretty great days. So we started working on your voice, and I remember that you did a cameo, not a cameo, a non-singing role in The Daughter of Regimen, and you were brilliant on stage, just fantastic and super funny. You didn't really get a chance for your voice to shine, but at the time, we were kind of working on your voice and all of that. Sure. And you took your lessons very seriously. So you graduated from high school and you decided you wanted to go to college for music. Tell us about that.
Well, it was really interesting because I was at a crossroads. You know, I mean, I had this girlfriend. I had a full ride to go to the University of Miami. I was really excited to go there, and you cast me in the next season's worth of operas. And I think the first one was Magic Flute. What was the role that you cast me in? It was the tenor role. He has the aria.
Monostatos.
Yeah.
It's kind of a character role, and because you were so funny on stage.
Yeah.
And your voice was really starting to come along.
So, but to me, I was like, wow, like, you know, I got cast in an opera. I'm going to have an aria to sing. Like, I'm, you know, and then you had, you know, you cast me in all the other shows too. And I was like, man, I can't go to Miami. I have to stay here. And so I made the tough decision 5 days before I was supposed to leave to go to Miami for the start of school. I told my parents, I'm like, I'm not going, I'm going to stay here. And I didn't even have a backup plan. So I had to register at UCF and we started working. And so then once I got to UCF, I decided to audition for music because I applied for business. And I'll never forget it. I finished my audition, and then there's silence, and then everybody starts laughing. And they're laughing at me because I had just tried to complete the sight reading exercise, which I told them I did not know how to sight read. And the head of the music department said to me, he goes, you know, you just don't have what it takes to be a singer. I think you should stay in the school of business. You seem like a bright young guy, but music just is not for you.
And well, I bet they're regretting that decision today.
Yeah, I mean, I was crushed in the moment, but honestly, I mean, what saved me was Central Florida Lyric Opera and the support and the family that, you know, that we had built there. And I was able to go back to you and my friends and perform and sing and find comfort. And finally, after a couple of weeks, you know, I said, you know what, I am going to prove them so wrong. They're really going to regret that and eat their words. And we, that's really when I decided to really take it seriously. And I mean, I looked at our lessons and practicing as a full-time job. I'd work 40, yeah. 50, 60 hours a week on it. And the rest is history, as I say.
And you did a lot of roles with Central Florida Lyric Opera. I mean, I can't remember all of them. I remember when you sang Pinkerton and you were just a kid.
Yeah,
and Lisa Albanese was the stage director.
Yeah, that was an incredible experience. I think overall it was 17 or 18 operas that I did with the Central Florida Lyric Opera with you. I mean, being able to do Lieutenant Pinkerton in Madama Butterfly with the legendary Licio Albanese, who's in the score. You know, I've never done anything like that, where the person that's staging, that you're working with, that's teaching you, that's coaching you, you open up the score and they're mentioned as one of the most you know, iconic butterflies in the history of the show. I mean, that was such an honor.
Pretty amazing. And you know, that's one of the really great things about our company, the Central Florida Lyric Opera, is that we're kind of like a family, and everybody just accepts everybody where they're at. I mean, think about those days when you were coming up through the ranks. You had Oscar Filiu and you know, Sam Reynolds, Mike Berryman, incredible singers. What's that?
And Paul Pitts.
Yeah, Paul Pitts, great people, and they kind of mentored you, and that's one of the things I'm proudest about our company. You know, I just feel like we're not only a place to learn, not only a place to perform, but a place to mentor, and that's awesome. And then you went, I remember you were a resident artist with the Palm Beach Opera.
Yeah, I got that offer to go be a resident artist with them, so I went for a year, and you know, that was an incredible experience, meeting more people, networking more. You know, I was able to cover Rodolfo in La Boheme. You know, and that was a, you know, it definitely was it was different. One of the things I experienced that was really different was there was no, there wasn't the same sense of family and camaraderie and mentorship. You know, that's one of the things I cherish the most from Central Florida Lyric Opera was just, you know, as a young singer, you're going to make mistakes. Your voice is still changing. You're going to have bad days. And I can't stress enough how much it meant for these, you know, older, more established singers, Noel, you know, King and Cheryl and Debbie Reynolds, and like all these people that just became just extended family and were there to kind of like, you know, counsel you and give you tips and advice and make you feel better. It was a rude awakening when I got to Palm Beach Opera because there was none of that. It was just kind of like, you know, eat or be eaten, shark eat shark. You know, it was a rough transition.
Yeah, you know, the last episode that we did of Talent Explosion, we had the great legendary Aprile Milo, who was on, and she talked about her experience in Southern California at one of those resident artist programs. And it was kind of the same thing for her back in those days. She was young and it was, you know, dog eat dog and that kind of thing. And then Licio was the one who told her, and that was long before I ever even met Licio. She told her, don't waste your time on some of these young artist programs because they're not going to foster you. They're not going to mentor you. They're not going to teach you. But anyway, so you had your first big break with America's Got Talent. Tell us all how that happened, how that all came about.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we met online, and honestly, I had auditioned for the show several times before. I had auditioned for American Idol and several seasons of America's Got Talent, and couldn't, you know, never got on. And you know, at that point, I had a decent career going. You know, I had a manager, I had an agent, I was earning a good living. And so this guy contacted me, you know, Josh, and he was like, "Hey, what do you think if we form a tenor group, and audition for America's Got Talent?" I was like, "Sure, I'll do it." But I mean, you know, don't hold your breath because, you know, it's tough to get their attention. And I don't know, we just captured lightning in a bottle and we went in. I mean, the first time we sang for an audience was at our audition, and I could tell within 10 seconds of that audition that we were going to go far. It was just, there was an electricity in the room. The audience was, their jaws were on the floor. The judges were in awe. And it was a crazy, insane ride. You know, considering we went in with no material. So literally we were learning new songs. As we found out we were moving on, we'd start working on the next week, arrangement and song selection. And it's just, for those that don't know what that's like, I mean, you don't generally prepare, a 3-part arrangement and then perform it on national television in the span of 5 or 6 days.
Right.
You know, and we're used to working on songs for weeks and months and preparing, and there was no time. So honestly,
well, I remember watching the show week after week after week, and you guys were phenomenal and consistently blew everyone away. And then, thanks to you, I had the great opportunity to come see you in the finals at Radio City Music Hall. Debbie and Sam Reynolds and I flew up for that, and thank you for that. And I was so proud. You know, when you're a voice teacher and you work with somebody and you mentor someone, you're lucky if even one of your students has international success like that. And I've been lucky because I've had so many successful students, but I think I was the proudest I've ever been in my life of one of my students, just to hear you in that. That was amazing. Tell me about how you got affiliated with the great David Foster.
Yeah, so David and I started performing David actually just before, 2 years before America's Got Talent. And he found a video of me on YouTube and contacted me and asked me to come sing for him in person. So I flew out and sang for him at his home in Malibu. And, he walks in and he's like, you know, I only got 10 minutes. I got to go to the studio. So pick out like 2 songs and we'll talk for like a couple minutes and then I got to go. And so I did, but that 10 minutes turned into 3 hours. And I think we sang through about 20 songs. And he just kept saying, do you know this song? Do you know this song? Do you know this song? And luckily every song he asked, I knew. And it's just become a great, a great friendship. I've traveled the world with David, all over Asia, all over North America. I've been able to sing with insane, stars and icons. And, you know, I've sang for Oprah and Barbara Streisand and, you know, opened for Lionel Richie, in Europe and sang with Lionel, you know, so it's when you're with David Foster, you just never know who's going to show up. I mean, Stevie Wonder calls during sound check and he puts him on speakerphone. We chat with him a little bit. David's, such a remarkable, composer, arranger, producer. It's rare that you get to, you know, share the stage with somebody like that. I mean, to me, David Foster's like he's a modern day Mozart or Beethoven. He's a master at what he does.
We have a little clip from a concert that you did with David Foster a few years ago. It's from Singapore and you were amazing. Let's just have a listen.
All right.
All right, the young gentleman that that came out here and sang with Haley, I'd like to bring him back, and I want him to do a song for you. Please welcome back Fernando Varela. Come on, Fernando. Oh. What's up, man?
How's it going?
Now, Fernando is from Orlando, Florida. You're not from Orlando. I discovered him on YouTube. And he's been with me for the last 6 months, and we're slowly building a beautiful career for this man, deservedly so. The interesting thing about Fernando is he kind of walks in two worlds. Let me just show you what I'm talking about. Fernando can do this. You ready? 2, 3.
When a man loves a woman, can't keep his mind on nothing, man. He'll trade the world. The good thing is found. If she's bad, he can't see it.
Okay. You get the idea. But what I want to do now is show you what he's really best at. He's good at a lot of things, but I want to show you what he's really best at. Watch this.
Tua apre la stanza, guardi le stelle che tremano d'amore e di speranza. Ma il mio mistero è chiuso in me, il nome mio nessun saprà.
There for you.
Absolutely amazing. And you end on a high D. Just blows my mind. Your range is really incredible, Fernando. Well, and you're so, so expressive. And you can tell David Foster loves you. And not only does he love you, you can tell that you guys have that personal, rapport. But also, I mean, you can tell he's blown away. At one point, he was sitting at the keyboard, and he just goes, oh, like that.
But there's a funny story about that, because we were, you know, I'd never done that. And I was in sound check once, like, I don't know, a few weeks before that. That was the Asia tour that I did with him. And we were at a private event in Beverly Hills. And at sound check, I was just, you know, just messing around. And I realized that the track that they played was down a full step. So they at soundtrack they chose the wrong track, and so it was down a half step. So I went up to a C, just messing around and soundcheck at the end. And David's like, "What was that? Like that's not written. I've never heard anybody do that." I'm like,
"Right, because Puccini didn't write that, but it's brilliant." No.
Yeah, and then it never became anything until that moment in Singapore. Literally, he didn't give me that was real. He got up and he's like, "Go up, go up, go up," in that moment, and I'm like, "All right, here we go. Here goes the ID." I had not prepared for it. It was not talked about, and ever since then, we've pretty much done it every time we've performed it.
Yeah, that's amazing. And I know on your recording with Forte, you also go up to the high D at the end.
Yeah.
I think it's brilliant. Puccini didn't write it, but you know what? Licia Albanese, she knew, Toscanini, and she specialized in the work of Puccini, she would have been fine with it. I know, yeah. Because she did stuff like that too.
Well, and I'll tell you what, I was in Germany, and one of the shows I was in got reviewed by a classical guy, and even he wrote, he goes, you know what? It's not written, and this is all in German, so I'm kind of paraphrasing and translating. It wasn't written, but knowing how much of a showman Puccini was, he is applauding right now in his grave.
Absolutely, absolutely. Okay, so you've had a chance to work with like all the greats. We don't have time to talk about all of them, but let's talk for a moment about a few of them. Sarah Brightman, Emilio and Gloria Estefan, Lionel Richie. Tell us about what it's like to work with icons. These are legends.
Yeah, at first I would be really really nervous and really intimidated the first few times, but after a while the greatest thing was that a lot of them would allow you to get to know them. You're not just singing on stage, you actually hang out, you'll have dinner, especially if you're on tour, you're really spending a lot of time with these people. And the greatest thing for me was just to realize these are just normal people that happen to have an amazing gift, an amazing talent, but the rest of them are normal, and they're just all like all of us. They're just looking for connection and wanting to make friends. And so once I realized that and started to get to know a lot of these people, it was great. Yeah, I mean, we toured all over Europe with Sarah Brightman, and Sarah's absolutely lovely. She's a lovely person. She's actually very low key off stage, and she's had this incredible career. People around her, that's a different story, but she is absolutely, phenomenal. And, Lionel's amazing. Lionel will talk to anybody and he'll give them advice. And he's very much, I worked with Lionel before he was on American Idol, but now you see him on American Idol, and that is Lionel. Like, he loves to, support and bring up young talent. He loves to encourage. He's there to inspire and to empower. He's very confident in his career. There is no jealousy or insecurity there. He's just a wonderful guy. And yeah, Emilio and Gloria Estefan have become family. I've done lots of stuff with them. I've worked with them in the studio. And of course I did they asked me to sing the Gershwin Prize from the Library of Congress that they received last year. It was on PBS. And that was an incredible opportunity and moment to be surrounded, Patti LaBelle's there and Jose Feliciano and tons of other stars and luminaries.
Tell us a little bit about this recording deal with Universal.
Yeah, so I received a big record deal with Universal, out of Germany, Deutsche Grammophon, which is probably the most respected classical label, definitely one of the oldest, and to be able to be part of that world and realize the giants and the greats that are on the same label as well, and the opportunities that afforded me was just incredible. Especially in Europe, I did a ton in Europe. I was in Germany probably once or twice a month. Every month for 2 years, kind of flying back and forth, and doing a bunch of television shows and promotion and writing and recording. So it was a thrill. It was a dream come true. I mean, I always wanted to get a big record contract, and that was an exciting time.
Awesome. And so, what's happening with this pandemic, and how is it affecting what you're doing right now, and what kinds of future things do you have planned?
Yeah, so I mean, obviously right now live performances are on hold. And we're very hopeful that a vaccine will come out, that rapid testing, I mean, that honestly everybody talks about vaccine, but I think rapid testing, cheap, affordable rapid testing is more important. If we could test everybody, then we can get back to doing things like concerts. Everybody would take a saliva test, before a concert, and everybody knows that everybody's COVID-free, and we don't have to worry in that moment. So, you know, I think there'll be a lot of innovation that'll bring it back, but you know, live shows are on hold, which is, I think it's been really hard for a lot of artists to not have that outlet. Of course, we've tried to do online things and try to, you know, do what we can do in the
time. Just kind of keep the ball rolling. Yeah.
Yeah. So I've decided instead to just write a lot and get in the studio and work on new music, you know, as kind of my outlet. So like I said, I'm working on a Christmas project that we'll be announcing relatively soon. It'll be released this year for Christmas. And
what about this? What about this Broadway show with David Foster?
Yeah, so I'm actually one of the producers on a new David Foster Broadway show that we're trying to get on Broadway probably in 2022. You know, once things kind of normalize, but it's very exciting. It's based on the Amy Bloom book called Lucky Us, and David's doing all the music. We're lining up some really big names to be the leads, and we've lined up a big name director. So it's actually been interesting with COVID because everything was canceled. So all of a sudden, all of these incredible people became available that weren't available, and we had started working on this before COVID. And when this opportunity came, I called David. I said, "This is actually the time to finish writing this show and line up the people." And so we started working behind the scenes, and I'll just tell you, it's the stuff that he's written for the show is just absolutely stunning. It's going to be a spectacular musical.
All right, and you're going to let me know where the auditions are, right? Me. I mean, I'm singing great these days. I want to be the star. I'll lose some weight and I'll play David.
You're fine. You don't need to lose any weight.
I think I'm typecast in David's part. I'm joking. I want to brag a little bit about an upcoming show that we have together at the Sharon, February the 13th, the Opera Club of the Villages. We are doing our annual fundraiser for the Harold Schwartz Musical Scholarship. And Fernando's going to be one of the tenors this year. Keep our fingers crossed he doesn't get torn away. We also have Devin Eatman, who's a favorite, and we're very proud that he's going to be in that. Also, we have a wonderful tenor from Boston. His name is Fran Rogers. He is a student of the great legendary Metropolitan Opera star, Deborah Voigt. And so he's going to be you guys are the three tenors. And then, again, we got to keep our fingers crossed. But it looks like our plus one this year is going to be Deborah Voigt herself. You know, I don't know how many Grammys and Emmys she's got, but a lot, and a huge star. And she's been a friend of mine for years. I was her accompanist for several concerts, and we've just gotten to know each other. And through this, like you said, through this COVID pandemic, all of us are kind of like twiddling our thumbs, not really being able to do much. And so in a way, it's kind of brought us closer together. I've been talking with her more and more, and it just so happened. I invited her. I just kind of threw it out there. What do you think about this? And she said, sure, I'd love to do it. So we've got a great lineup for that concert, February 13th at the Sharon Theater. I don't know when tickets go on sale. It won't be for another couple of months, but I want everybody to be on the lookout for that. Three tenors plus one, sponsored by the Opera Club of the Villages. We're going to close our show today with a wonderful clip of you singing. This is your PBS special that you did called Coming Home. And I picked it for a specific reason. Well, two specific reasons. The first was the song. I think it's an amazing song, and I had the great privilege, thanks to you, of conducting the orchestra on this song for your PBS special. And so we're gonna leave the show with this beautiful clip of this great song. Fernando, thank you so much for joining us today. And we look forward to all the exciting things that you've got coming down the pike, especially here in the Villages. God bless you and have a great day.
God bless you too. Thanks for having me, Bill. Love you all. Thank you.
Bye.
So I'm very honored to have one of the very first people that ever believed in me. And that was my very first voice teacher, Maestro Bill Doherty. Everybody give a hand to Bill. Bill, I must say, I think you saw something in me that I didn't even see in myself. And I could think of nobody better to conduct this next original song than you.
Tired of waiting, tired of waiting for your chance. Time to awaken. Know that it's your life in your hands. The thrill of the moment, the thrill of the moment when you see. It's like walking on oceans. It's taking a miracle to believe. So let go of everything you think you know and spread your wings. It's time your dreams came true. I know there's nothing you can do. From the fire in a heart of desire is hard to breathe when it's down to the wire. Just look in the mirror for your destiny. So let go of everything you think you know and spread your.
thank you so much for joining us for today's show. I want to take this opportunity to invite you to go to centralfloridalyricopera.org. Make a donation to keep beautiful music flowing. If you click on the donate button, the PayPal donate button, your donations will go to help support the artists that you've heard today on the show, as well as to help support our company and to keep us rolling during this COVID-19 pandemic, and to enable us to continue to bring beautiful music to you. Thank you so much for joining us, and good night.